I arrived on a farm in 2013, irrigated farm on the banks of the Orange River. We mostly do wheat and maize in rotation, and everybody in this area are already doing no-till on all of the maize crop. So I arrived here and I thought, well, if we're doing the maize like this and you could just see the soil improving in the no-till conditions, and we started experimenting with no-till of wheat, didn't always work. And then I went to a lot of the farmers in South Africa that's doing it already. The longer I got into this, I realized that there must be better ways and we can be more clever than we are at the moment in terms of using chemicals and even chemical fertilizers. So I really started experimenting with organic no-till. And on the other hand, we do what I call conservation agriculture, which is a wheat maize rotation. Then on the organic no-till side, we do very long rotations. So we will only do one or two cash crops in 2 years' time. And in between, it's cover cropping, mob grazing. We use green planting, we use rollers, no-till planters. I use a small equalizer. I use intercropping. We're now experimenting with relay cropping also. And we're doing interesting experiments where we are testing the amount of biodiversity in the organic system versus the conservation agriculture system versus the full-on cover cropping system. And for me, it's great to see the differences and to push ourselves like as far as we can. Our crucial first biggest changes probably was just going full no-till on the wheat. I felt that we didn't get the yields we wanted, so we tried to replace the wheat with cover crops and livestock. And I always felt that the maize after any of those were better than maize just after a quick wheat. It was the biggest step. And the second one was bringing in grazing management where we started to move the cattle every day. And I could really see the soil improve with that step. This is a certified organic maize field. So this was drilled straight into a wheat and veg and clover cash crop. So we harvested the wheat and we separated the seeds afterwards. And then we came straight in with the maize. We did a sun-hemp cowpeas. And then we planted the maize in between. So yeah, there's a lot of plants a hectare. The maize is on 80,000 and the cowpeas and the sun-hemp is about on 200,000-250,000 a hectare. So lots of plants, lots of roots. No bare soil. The soil has got great structure. All this wheat stubble really helps the infiltration rate on this field. Really, really very happy with the soil structure. The legumes just balances the soil. Leave some nitrogen in here for the next crop. And this field has been no-till now for 3-4 years. In here we use mostly manure. And we used the cover crops as fertilizers, so there was no chemical fertilizers. This is a GM-free varietal, nothing sprayed on it. So it's not the biggest heads ever, but really they look healthy. I'm very, very happy with this crop. The biggest hurdles I experienced initially in the grain side of our farming operation, we didn't get the yields that I expected we're going to get in the beginning. And on the other hand, what kept me going was that on the perennials, in the orchards, on the pecanuts and on the vineyards, the yields just went up. So I thought if we can manage to do that on the perennial stuff, then we have to find answers for the grains. But yeah, that was the biggest challenge, to not just look at yields, but to look at a longer system and to look at the total setup. As far as the integration of livestock goes, when we use cover crops in our system, we still need to pay for the electricity, for the pump of the water, so there's pressure on the livestock to perform a financial function, not just a soil health function. So we have cattle, we have sheep, we have pigs now, and obviously the chickens must follow as soon as we can manage that. As far as livestock goes, cattle is for us the first option. It's always the easiest to manage for me. They work with one wire, you can move them 2-3 times a day. They are ruminants, so we don't feed them any grains. They're 100% pasture fed. Okay, this is our cattle in an annual cover crop mix. What we have here is white oats, veg, radish, and annual ryegrass. Normally we have about 200 animals on a 30 hectare pivot. Move them twice a day, so the rest period will be about a month before we start over again. We'll do a no-till maize here. Just a bit of an earlier maize crop. So we'll get this maize in November instead of December like we do after wheat. This cover crop we use in our normal wheat maize system just to kind of break the cycle of wheat and maize a bit. What I like about sheep is you can use them under the vineyards, under the pecanuts, where they don't do the damage that the cattle does. And lamb is a bit of an easier sell in the market. This is a mix of perennial grasses, lucerne or alfalfa, chicory, which has got a nice deep root, broadleaf. There's clover, it's also a perennial, then there's veg. I normally start off planting cereal rye or oats with this mix. And then in summer, I try to add something like lucerne, maybe buckwheat, something that can give flower for predators and pollinators. And in our system, where it takes you 3 years to convert a conservation agriculture field to an organic certified field, this is the best way for me to go through that 2 or 3 years to build up the soil and also to get some money off from this land by grazing sheep or cattle or even pigs. So after this 3 years, we'll do a pumpkin, no-till wheat, maize after each other, and then we'll go back into this perennial grazing. I really like this diversity. Lots of deep roots, shallow roots. There's legumes in here, grasses. Good balance between carbon and nitrogen in the soil. We graze it intensively, and then we give it a month to recover before we start all over again. Our pigs will eat all the pumpkins that we couldn't export because of fruit flies or because of size or whatever. And then they also break the pest cycles by eating their pumpkins. They will clean anything we want them to clean. So if there's an old pumpkin field, an old maize field, we'll put them through there and they'll basically clean it for us. They will also eat the bran and everything that comes out of our milling operation. So we do stone ground milling, and then everything that's sifted out, like the veg seed from our wheat or like little stubble from the maize, all that goes to the pigs. And that kind of closed the circle for us from the milling operation, so that we try to create no waste. The pigs use it, and then we also sell the pigs directly to the market. Okay, so here we have the pigs in the vineyard now. This is our Shiraz. This has been certified organic now since 2013. And we use this for our own wine. This one goes into a wine we call the Verlore Bokwe, which means the lost she goat. So what we do now is what I call the autumn cleanup. So normally we get the cattle or the sheep to come through the vines, to clean it, to fertilize it, and then we move them back to greener pastures. But this year we decided to use the pigs, because the pigs are really plowing. They're just giving us the opportunity to get the seeds in here now. Next week we'll sow the veg seeds, and then we are growing a live mulch under the vines. So then we don't need to come in here with mulch that we had to bale from the other fields. So everything that you need in the vines is just growing here. This is our Colombar. We use these vineyards to make a wine we call the Falkameel Colombar. And the pigs were in here about 3 weeks ago. And behind the pigs we sow veg, and this is Saradella, and there's some wheat in there. So this is basically a green mulch. The veg will grow, and then when the vines start overshadowing it in December, it gets too warm, and then they die off. And we've got nice cover for the roots, bringing the soil temperature down and preserving moisture. And obviously fixing some nitrogen for us. The biggest principles to understand in a switch over time for me was that it's going to be a learning curve. I'm trying to save myself time by using small areas and push it all the way, and rather calibrate back. So I would do organic no-till on 4 hectares and just go full out. And if it works, it works. If it doesn't work, I try and bring it back a step. And the other thing for me was to realize that as we're in Prieska and we don't have so many options on grains because we can't sell it in our area, for me the big thing was just to go and find new markets. To try and get into a system where we've got more options and we can plant more diversity and we can maybe get in a longer rotation. So here is an experiment that I'm doing. It's something I'm very passionate about. It's fusion of agroforestry and permaculture. Basically what we're trying to do here is we designed this 2-3 hectares to minimize the erosion from the water that when there's a big rain event, the runoff is coming from this little hills here and from the road. And it used to make this huge erosion damage here. And then we said, okay, well, let's try this permaculture experiment. So basically we designed a permaculture orchard on contour. So this is 10 meters between the swales or the contours. And what we're doing now is the first 2 meters, we're doing a very high intensity food forest, basically. So this is basically a pecan orchard that we took from our own existing orchard, the best performing ones. And then this is apple trees that was grown for lower cold units. And the next row here, we're going to put in vineyards. And in between the pecanuts, we're still going to put date trees. And the whole idea is to experiment with different crops, different trees, different varietals. And then this part is on one irrigation line. And then in between the rows, we have another irrigation line. At this moment, we just planted cover crops in here behind the pigs. But the plan is to do very high income vegetable crops in summer. So we want to see how far we can push our income per hectare on this piece of land. I definitely learned the most about conservation agriculture by visiting farmers that's been doing it successfully. Not so much seeing what they're doing, but rather just standing around the fire and exchanging ideas. And also from watching other guys around the world and just seeing what's possible. I think sometimes you feel like, well, what the hell am I doing? And then you'll see someone on YouTube that's been doing it for 20 years and the first 10 years they struggled and then suddenly everything starts to work. So I think for me, it's just important to keep learning, to speak to as many people as possible. Even if it's just to stay energized, I think that's the best thing. Okay, so this field is like my passion project. This is where I try to combine like all the practices that I've seen that really excites me. So what I want to try and do here is we planted a cover crop of wheat and faba bean or broad bean. And we left spaces for relay pumpkin. That's organic pumpkins that we do for export. We did no-till planting of the wheat. It's 19 centimeter spacing, so it's 2 rows open, 2 rows closed, 2 rows open, 2 rows closed. And then we came in with a no-till planter with a faba bean where we did 76 centimeters, but it's 2 rows faba bean, 1 open, 2 rows faba bean, 1 open. So now the idea is to come in with that same planter and we're going to plant the pumpkins in that open rows, which is going to be 2.28 meters, so 228 centimeters. And then when we harvest this at the end of November, the pumpkins should be well established and ready to just put out their arms and really grow into the space left open by the wheat and the faba bean. If we want to go into rotation next season where we want to do organic maize, we have the option now of planting the maize straight into the rows where the faba bean was growing, so where we're going to have more nitrogen available for the maize crop. To have the option of bringing something like faba bean into our system as a cash crop, it's really exciting for me. This is obviously a way out trial, but yeah, I'm really excited about this. We as farmers are getting better and better by joining forces, study groups, getting data out there. But I think we are not including the chefs and the consumers. And without them, nothing's gonna change. And I think for us, it's our duty to really work with the people who's buying the product and to help them understand the different regenerative, sustainable, organic, biological. I mean, it's all these concepts flying around, no-till. And I realize that we are not even sure what all of that mean. I don't know how we expect the consumer to understand all the different practices. So yeah, I think data for us under irrigation, there's not a lot of data under irrigation. I think that's something we need to work on, irrigation farmers. And then yeah, we need to work with the consumers more. I feel like in Prieska, we're 50 kilometers out of town. We ate 900 from Durban, so we're probably the furthest farm, except for our one neighbor, to get fertilizer in the world. So if we in Prieska can close the loops and we can get to a system where everything is working together, it's like a systems design. If we can design the system with livestock moving through, everything playing a part, cattle trampling and leaving some manure behind. You get the sheep coming in the vineyards at certain times. We have the pigs coming through problem areas, plowing with a nose, and we can make our own compost, we can do agroforestry. For me, the long-term vision is to use all of these concepts to get to a place where the whole system works together without us getting any inputs from outside. And that is where we want to be. We, as farmers, must put out nutritious food to the world, not just volumes of food, but good food. And for me, that is the biggest thing.